Hi, I'm Amanda Teicher. I'm an art student in Seattle. In this video, I will demonstrate how I prepare a Dibond panel to be a support for an oil painting. I hope you enjoy it. Dibond is a brand of aluminum composite panel, which is two thin sheets of aluminum around a polyethylene core. Dibond comes most commonly in 3 millimeter thickness in the top sample, and its most common finish is white. It won't change in response to changes in temperature or humidity, and unlike stretched canvas, it won't rot. Dibond is thinner than plywood. You can see three standard pieces of plywood on the left and three pieces of 3 millimeter Dibond on the right. So it's much easier to use for larger paintings. And you can see I'm demonstrating its rigidity. It has a little bit of flex in this large 3 millimeter sheet, but once it's framed, it would hold its shape quite well. And also, it's very lightweight. I have no trouble lifting a large piece. When I decided to buy Dibond panel, I did a Google search for the manufacturer and I found 3A Composites. On their website, they have a distributors page. So I went there and I entered my zip code. And I reduced the search radius to 10 miles, and I found 7 distributors in Seattle, 2 of which I visited. Dibond comes in 4-foot by 8-foot sheets normally. I asked the shop to cut mine into 3 roughly equal pieces so they'd fit into my car. And as you can see, my little dog Dudley is supervising this entire process very carefully. If you're wondering, why should I take advice about materials from a student? Well, it's because I get advice from a lot of artists. One blog I like is called Painting Stuff to Look Like Stuff. It's written by Kate Stone and Dave Gluck. And I think it's very useful, especially one post from about a year ago about Dibond panel. If you visit their blog and you scroll down to the list of labels, click on Tricks of the Trade. This is all the practical advice. And then you'll need to scroll down because the post was written about a year ago. And it's called More Apocalypse Surviving Panels. There it is. This is a long post about the reasons to use Dibond panel and a process for preparing it to use in oil painting. I follow Kate's process pretty closely, and you'll notice in a photo that's coming up, it looks like she's brushed the gesso onto her panel with a house painter's brush. Later on in this video, you'll see that I apply my gesso with a roller. I think both methods are good, just different. At the end of the post, there's lots of comments and questions and answers, which is just as helpful as the post. So I'm going to use this rubbing alcohol to clean the surface of the Dibond panel before I start sanding it. The file is for cleaning the edges, which can be rough. This is a snap-off utility knife. It has a long, extendable blade, and when it gets dull, you just snap off a segment. I'm using this tool because aluminum needs to be cut with a very sharp blade, so I just snap off a few segments during the cutting process. This is medium grit sandpaper for creating texture on the surface of the Dibond before applying gesso. And these brushes are helpful for cleaning up aluminum sawdust. And a straight edge and a piece of masking tape. I'm just noticing here a little imperfection in the surface of the panel. So I'm going to use the other side as my painting surface. And this side looks better. So my first step will be to mark the dimensions of the panel, having figured out the composition of the painting before this. I'm using a Sharpie, and I found the newest, sharpest Sharpie in the house to make this line. Now I'm going to secure the straight edge to the panel with masking tape. When I was doing research about cutting Dibond with hand tools, I read that keeping the straight edge in place is one of the most important things you can do to avoid hurting yourself. I've gotten used to having fingers, so I decided to follow that advice.
So I positioned the straight edge before I pressed the tape down onto the panel. So I'm going to start cutting with this utility knife. I'm using light pressure at first. This process will take a while. If you're patient, it's not bad. I gradually increase the pressure, and you can see that my workbench isn't as wide as the panel, so I'm trying to keep the pressure over the workbench. The beginning and the end of each cut are the hardest, so I usually put extra cutting effort into the beginning and the ending. So now I'm going to test the panel and see if I've cut far enough through it so that I can bend it. Not quite. Okay, back to cutting. I'll keep going. This is cheaper than buying a table saw. I think safer than using a table saw, and I don't have sawdust made from aluminum flying all over my studio. There's still going to be aluminum shavings and aluminum sawdust, but it's not as bad. So here I've just snapped off a segment of the blade. It was starting to get dull, and I saw that I had this little tiny piece of sharp blade, so I'm folding it into a piece of masking tape. There we go. That's not going to hurt anybody, man or beast. And into the garbage. Back to cutting with a sharp blade. Let's try this again, this time with feeling. And it worked. So I've weakened the aluminum on the other side. I've cut through the plastic, the polyethylene. And with enough bending, all I'll have to do is make a few little cuts and it'll separate. Success. Two pieces of Dibond panel. The edges are rough and they've got some aluminum shavings on them, so I'm going to try and make sure that all those aluminum shavings end up in the garbage and not getting inhaled or stepped on by a person or a dog. So my next step will be to smooth out the edges, and I'm going to use a file for that, and then sandpaper. The edges are rough and I don't want to hurt myself. And when I take the finished painting to a frame shop, I don't want anybody there to hurt themselves. It doesn't take that much to make the edges nice and smooth. So I'm going to go around all four sides with a file, and then I'll flip the panel over and do it again. Okay, finishing up the sanding. Now I'm going to clean the floor. We have a little VIP who uses the studio floor. To prime the panel, I'm going to use a 4-inch foam roller that I bought at a home improvement store and acrylic gesso from Daniel Smith. I like this brand of gesso quite a bit. I've read that acrylic forms a stronger bond between the support and the oil paint than oil-based gesso would. So I've cleaned the surface and dried it, and now I'm sanding. I'm trying to get enough texture into the surface so that the gesso will cling to it. I guess technically it's an acrylic dispersion ground, but gesso is just quicker and easier to say. Cleaning off the sawdust from the panel surface. Sorry about the focus problems. My camera uses autofocus when it's in video mode, so it just does that. I'm going to clean it a second time, and once it's dry, I'll start applying gesso. So to get the gesso into the painting tray, I'm just dipping the roller in. I don't need to pull that much of it out into the tray. I just want to make sure it's that the roller is evenly loaded before I start applying it. It's pretty straightforward. In between layers of gesso, I have not been sanding. I don't think it needs it. It's pretty textured. If I wanted to get a glassy, smooth surface, I would sand the final layer, and maybe I would sand in between layers. But I'm pretty happy with the end product the way it is. I don't want to rinse out or wash out the roller in between layers of gesso, so I'm covering it with plastic wrap. This is my second layer of gesso. The panel is now dry. It's been an hour or two. And I'm applying it in a perpendicular direction. This is lengthwise. The first layer was crosswise. Trying to get it even. In the end, it'll have three or four coats of gesso. So if you look carefully, you can see that the texture is similar to charcoal paper, or a little smoother. And here I'm applying paint without any medium and without any solvent onto a sample piece of gessoed panel where I did not sand the gesso, so you get a bit of texture. I'm going to wipe the paint off as though I were doing a wipeout underpainting, just to show that the gesso is fairly absorbent. But you can still manage to make a wipeout underpainting. So I think that we are very lucky to live in an age where we can use traditional techniques and modern materials if we choose. Thank you for watching my video. I hope it was helpful.